And I'd like to welcome each one of you out here this night. Tonight's subject is going to be Four Beasts and Little Horn, Part 1. Then tomorrow night, we'll be back for Part 2, 7 o'clock as well. And then we'll be back Sunday for The Power of Church and State, Part 1. And then we'll be back again Monday for The Power of Church and State, Part 2. I'm just going to give you an overview right now of the seminar. And then Tuesday, we will not have a meeting. Okay, this is for the next 5 days so far that we're looking at. And then our subject, the image and the law, will pick up after that. And then we'll have another subject called spiritualism, worldwide deceit. And then our last subject matter is going to be an angel's loud cry. And those are future presentations that will be coming up. Tonight's subject is four beasts and a little horn. Now I want to ask the group here, is anybody in need of a Bible? We're going to be opening up the scripture tonight. We're going to be reading from the Bible. So if anybody is in need of a Bible, if you would like to raise your hand, I see one here, two. If we can get people a Bible that they can use as we read. And we will be using the King James Bible. And there are some Bible principles that we're going to be looking at tonight. We're laying a foundation for prophecy. So tonight we're going to look at a prophecy, actually two prophecies, that actually are the same prophecy recorded in different places in the Bible. But we're going to lay foundations that will help us throughout the seminar for the understanding of deeper prophecies in the Bible. So in Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, I want to start with, says, God, who is sundry, now word sundry means various, sundry times and in diverse manners, spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets. Now let me explain this here, because this will help us as we go through the rest of these verses here. God spoke to the fathers through the prophets. Let me give you some examples to help us understand this. There was a king of Israel. His name was King David. Everybody familiar with King David? Did he have, or should I say, did God have a prophet for King David? Does anybody know? What was that prophet's name? Nathan. So God, even though he had the king in place, King David, God spoke through a prophet, Nathan. Now there was another king that was just before King David. His name was King Saul. Now God also had a prophet for King Saul. Anybody know that prophet's name? It was Prophet Samuel. As the Bible tells us in Hebrews, God, who at various times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. Now, who's the Son? It's Jesus. You know, Jesus has a book. It's this book here. In John chapter 1, verse 1, we don't need to turn there. We'll look at this in an upcoming night. But in John chapter 1, verse 1, it talks about Jesus. It talks about the flesh, or it talks about the Word. And the Word was with God, and Word was God. And in verse 14 of the same chapter, it says the Word was made flesh. Well, this is the Word, and it was made flesh. That flesh is the Son. Hath in these last days, God has spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the... Now, look at that word, worlds. Now, it's not our subject for tonight, but that word is plural. We are not the only inhabited planet in God's universe. But that's not our subject tonight, but that's an interesting point I wanted to bring out. But in these last days, God is speaking to us through Jesus. Now, let me ask a question. Does Jesus literally leave heaven and come here and preach to us? He does it in a special way. It says this in John chapter 16, verse 7. Jesus speaking, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him, the Comforter, to you." So in 31 AD, when Jesus went back to heaven, he's telling his disciples, and he's telling us too, it's expedient, it's very important, it's urgent that I go to heaven because I need to go there to send you the Comforter. You with me on this? So the question is, who's the Comforter? Well, this is John 16, verse 7. John 14 tells us in verse 26, "But the Comforter, which is the..." And that's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's the Comforter. Jesus had to go back to heaven to send the Holy Spirit. So God speaks to us through his Son, and the Son is using the part of the Godhead, the third of the Godhead called the Holy Spirit, which is also the Comforter, to come to us, whom the Father will send in my name. And he, the Holy Spirit, shall do what? Teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatever he wants to do. Is that what the Bible says? No, the Holy Spirit's only going to teach us those things which Jesus has already taught, that Jesus has already spoken, and the Word became flesh. Here's the Word written, right? So we are to test everything to the Bible. And I find it amazing. You go out and you teach from the Bible. You show something so clear from the Bible. And you have people say, you know, I see it in the Bible, but I need to go home and pray about it. I need to go home and let the Holy Spirit, wait on the Holy Spirit to tell me if it's true. No. When the Bible, you see it clearly from the Bible, that is the Holy Spirit speaking to you. We need to test even inclinations. We need to test anything that comes to us. Paul said, if any man or angel speak unto you any other gospel other than that which we have spoken, let that man or angel be what? Anybody know? Accursed. We are to test everything to the Bible, even impressions from spirits. Holy Spirit, it may not be the Holy Spirit. We need to test it to the Bible. But the Holy Spirit is going to teach us all things and bring all things to our remembrance, whatsoever Jesus has said unto us. That's John chapter 14. The Holy Spirit is going to teach us. It says this in John chapter 16, verse 13. Howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will... What does that mean? He's going to teach, he's going to guide, he's going to show you from Jesus' words what truth is. And then he's going to help you to understand it and live it. He's going to guide you into that truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear. And we know from John chapter 14, Holy Spirit is going to teach what Jesus has already spoken. But it also, the Holy Spirit is going to show us what? What are those last three words? Things to come. Now there's a word that means a foretelling of things to come. Anybody know what that word is? Prophecy. It's the Holy Spirit that teaches us prophecy. It's the Holy Spirit that's going to help guide us into an understanding of prophecy. John 14, 29, Jesus says, and now I have told you before it comes to pass, that when it comes to pass, ye might do what? Believe. That word believe there is synonymous with the word faith. I can't explain how it works, but Jesus tells me that when I understand the things that comes to pass that he has foretold, when I understand the prophecies and I see the fulfillment of it, somehow, some way, God says, my faith can increase. Faith in what? Well, John chapter 13, verse 19 says, Jesus says, now I tell you before it come, that when it has come to pass, that's seeing the fulfillment of prophecy, ye may believe that I am he. We'll have a deeper belief in Jesus. Amen? There's something about prophecy. Hi, how are you doing tonight? There's something special about prophecy. The Bible is pointing us to prophecy. Jesus points us to prophecy. So we must begin by asking two very important questions in this prophecy seminar. First question is, what is prophecy? It's important. Holy Spirit's going to teach us it. Jesus says that our faith can grow when we understand it. It's important to understand what is prophecy. And the second one is, where can we find true and reliable prophecy? That's an important question too, because there's a lot of people looking for ways to understand the future. Some people go to these things. What is prophecy? Well, let's first look at this. New Oxford Dictionary gives us the definition of prophecy, which is a prediction of future events, a forecast. That's what prophecy is. So the second question is, where can we find true and reliable prophecy? Why is this important? Because some people go to these things, right? Now, how many has driven down Route 29 going towards Charlotte? You know exactly what I'm talking about. They just had their house remodeled, didn't they? Got those expensive cars sitting outside, didn't they? Why is it they have the money to do that? Because people go to these things to understand what's in the future. Can we trust those things? No. Not at all, not at all. Some people call the 1-900 numbers and these various things. Now, I find this one interesting. See here where it says the second coming in 1998. Who do you think it was that made that prediction back then? Anybody know his name? Harold. Now, didn't this guy, Harold Camping, just recently redo these predictions that the end of the world is going to come May of 2011? And then when that didn't come to pass, he goes, oh, I had it wrong. I calculated it wrong. It's actually October 21st. But that was just a few months ago. Did it happen? Or a few days ago, a few weeks ago. Did it happen? No. Unreliable prophets. The Bible talks about false prophets. Test everything to the Bible. Now, these magazines, let me ask a question. When you stand in the checkout lines in a newspaper, do you ever look down and read the headlines? Yeah. They know right where to market those, don't they? Right next to the register. Well, I was, actually, the day that I was presenting this message tonight, a few years back, I was at a grocery store, Food Lion in Gordonsville, as a matter of fact. And I was going through the line that day, and I looked down, and I saw this one right here, and I bought it. This was from October 17th of 2005. That was the date on it. It was actually a few days before that date I purchased it. And the reason why I purchased it was so I could scan it, because that's our subject. Antichrist in the Bible. This says Antichrist in Washington. But I find this interesting. Can you guess his or her identity? And look at all these political people. And that's the main thinking in the world today when it comes to the Antichrist, is has to do with politics. Well, we're going to learn what the Bible says about it as we go through this seminar. We're going to have an understanding. This is from Bernard McGinn. He's a specialist at the University of Chicago Divinity School. He said, over the past 30 years, more scholarship has been devoted to apocalypticism, and that word is just a big old fancy theologian word for last day events. But more scholarship has been given for that than in the last 300 years of anything else. There's an interest for prophecy. Do you have an interest for prophecy? I know I do. This Newsweek magazine is actually from 1999, but it makes the statement what the Bible says about the end of the world. Does anybody remember this magazine coming out in the newsstands about 12 years ago? Anybody? You remembered it? Did anybody read what Newsweek said the Bible says? You know, I was thinking about this earlier today as I was going through this seminar, this presentation. Why would we go to Newsweek to find out what the Bible says when we could just go to the Bible for ourselves? And if we pray, as we should, as Ron did for us before we started this presentation tonight, for the Holy Spirit to teach us, and then I can understand this for myself. How about you? Do you think you can? I tell you, I am a firm believer that the Holy Spirit can teach us in a moment what it takes a man a lifetime to learn in his own powers. I believe. Do you believe that? Because the power of the Holy Spirit to be our teacher and to guide us to the truth and the things that Jesus already said is very good. Don't go to Newsweek to find out what the Bible says. I wonder how that would apply to those books in the Christian bookstore. Should we go to a Christian book to find out what the Bible says? We should go for ourselves, right? So what does the Bible say? Well, Isaiah 46, verses 9 and 10 says, remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is none else. I am God and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times the things that are not yet done. I can trust God because God is the God of the beginning and the end. I trust God and His Word because He knows the beginning from the end. What about those that are reading their crystal balls, or down there, that nice house with those fancy cars down the street? I trust the Word of God. That's where I put my faith. Jesus, I believe, is aware of everything that's taken place. He knows what's about to take place because He knows the beginning from the end. And if you agree with that, say amen. All right, let's move on. 30% of the Bible, 30% of this book is prophecy. Did you know that? So if I was to take this book and divide it right in half, I'm just going to do it just not exactly accurate, that's 50%. So if I moved about this much over here, could we say that's about 30% right here? That much of this book is prophecy. Did you know that? And unlike the failed predictions of the psychics, I think of Harold Camping even as that false prophet, the Bible has been accurate for the last 3,500 years. No mistakes with the Bible. No mistake. All anybody has to do to prove the Word of God wrong is find something in this book that's false. And then it's all out the window, right? Do you think anybody has tried to do that? Has anybody been successful? We can trust the Bible. Yes, the Bible is truth. It can be trusted. Do you trust the Bible? Again, Jesus says in John 14, 29, now I have told you before it come to pass, that when it comes to pass, you might believe. So let's get into this. There are two general classes of prophecy. Well, first type is classical prophecy. The second type, classical prophecy, you find the books of Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Zechariah, Amos, Obadiah, to name a few. And most Bible prophets fit into this category. It's called classical prophecy. The second type is called apocalyptic prophecy. And those classical prophets, they contain apocalyptic prophecy, but when you look at apocalyptic prophecy, there's a main book in the Old Testament and a main book in the New Testament that focuses on apocalyptic prophecy. And the one in the Old Testament is the book of Daniel. The one in the New Testament is the book of Revelation. They both fit like a hand in a glove. You need to study both together to understand each other. You cannot study Revelation setting Daniel aside, and you will not understand Revelation without the book of Daniel, and vice versa. They are the same vision God gave to two different men. We're using different symbols and different variations of it, and you have to study the two together. And we're going to see that through this seminar, how they fit together. Amos chapter 3, verse 7, God says through this prophet, surely the Lord God will do nothing. But he revealed his secret to his servants, the prophets. You know, Jesus named a prophet that we should study. Did you know that? Jesus actually names a prophet from the Old Testament we should study. It's found in Matthew chapter 24, verse 15. Jesus says, when you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by who?
Daniel
the prophet. Now, Jesus called Daniel a prophet. Surely the Lord God will do nothing except he revealeth his secrets to his servants, the prophets. And Jesus is saying, Daniel the prophet. When you see it, this prophecy that Daniel spoke about, you think it might be wise to study the book of Daniel? You better believe it. Better believe it. So what Jesus wants to do, he wants to pull back that curtain. He wants to reveal these things. He wants to pull back that curtain of misunderstanding. He wants to pull back that curtain of lack of understanding. And through his Holy Spirit, the Son is going to teach us and speak to us by his word. And the Holy Spirit is going to help us to understand this. So what I want us to do, take your Bibles. Open up to Daniel chapter 2. Daniel chapter 2 as we begin tonight. Daniel chapter 2. Does anybody need a Bible? That does not have one. So let's open up to Daniel chapter 2, and we'll go through this. And we're going to do as Jesus said. We're going to go to the book of Daniel and study. Now, I'm going to put verses 1 and 2 on the screen. An overview of Daniel 2 is the king of Babylon. His name is Nebuchadnezzar, Tyrus Nebuchadnezzar. He's asleep. He has this dream, and this dream wakes him up. And that's just what's taking place in this chapter. Verses 1 and 2 I'll put on the screen, and then we'll continue through it from the Bible. It says in Daniel chapter 2, verse 1, and in the second year of the reign, Nebuchadnezzar dreamed dreams, wherewith his spirit was troubled, and his sleep brake from him. Then the king commanded to call the magicians, and the astrologers, and the sorcerers, and the Chaldeans, for to show the king his dream. So they came and stood before the king. So Nebuchadnezzar, he had this dream. It woke him up. He didn't know what the dream was, and we'll review this in this chapter in a moment. And so he called all these people in, the magicians, the astrologers, the sorcerers. He called his spiritual advisors. You follow that? Wouldn't this group be his spiritual advisors? So he said, come on in here. You got your Bibles? We just read verses 1 and 2 in Daniel chapter 2. Let's pick it up in verse 3. And the king said unto them, I have dreamed a dream, and my spirit was troubled to know the dream. Then spake the Chaldeans to the king in Syriac, O king, live forever. Tell thy servants the dream, and we will show the interpretation. The king answered and said unto the Chaldeans, the thing is gone from me. If you will not make known unto me the dream, with the interpretation thereof, ye shall be cut in pieces, and your houses shall be made a dunghill. Now that is pretty strong. I can't remember what I dreamed, but you better tell me what I dreamed. And not only that, tell me what it means. I don't know. I don't think I would want to be one of these spiritual advisors. And that's it. Would you? Not at all. In verse 6, but if you show the dream and the interpretation thereof, ye shall receive of me gifts and rewards and great honor. Therefore, show me the dream and the interpretation thereof. They answered again and said, let the king tell his servants the dream, and we shall will show the interpretation thereof. The king answered and said, I know of certainty that you would gain the time. In other words, he's saying, I know what you're trying to do. You're trying to buy time to figure out what you're going to do. You're in a difficult situation. You are my spiritual advisors. I dreamed this dream. I can't remember what it is. Now I'm calling on you to tell me what I dreamed, and you can't do it. And you're stalling for time. You see that? That's what he's saying there. The king, verse 8, the king answered and said, I know of certainty that ye would gain the time, because ye see the thing is gone from me. But if you will not make known unto me the dream, there is but one decree for you. For ye have prepared lying and corrupt words to speak before me till the time be changed. Therefore tell me the dream, and I shall know that ye can show me the interpretation thereof. And the Chaldeans answered before the king and said, there is not a man upon the earth that can show the king's matter. Therefore there is no king, lord, nor ruler that asks such things at any magician or astrologer or Chaldeans. And it is a rare thing that the king requireth, and there is none other that can show it before the king except the gods whose dwelling is not with flesh. Except the what? The. Notice that's a little g plural. That's not God the creator. That's not the God Amos 3:7 said that knows the beginning from the end. This is gods. Little g plural. Let's pause here a second. I'm going to show you something. I want to talk about these gods, little g plural, just for a moment, because this, what I'm going to explain now, will help us in an upcoming presentation. These gods, little g plural, the Bible talks about. Did you know that? Let's take a look. Put your finger or put a marker there in Daniel chapter 2. What I want us to do is let's turn to 1 Samuel chapter 28. Keep a marker there in Daniel chapter 2, and let's turn to 1 Samuel chapter 28. We're going to learn something about these little gods here. Now, what we find in 1 Samuel chapter 28, remember when I brought up the kings of Israel? The first king of Israel was King Saul. Remember, I brought him up at the beginning of the presentation. And King Saul, God had a prophet for him, and his name was what? Does anybody remember? Samuel, that's right. So it came to the point where King Saul rejected God so much that God said, King Saul, I'm shutting down communication with you. I'm not going to discuss anything with you anymore. I'm not going to talk to you. I'm taking away that ability. So in 1 Samuel chapter 28, is everybody there? I still see some people turning. Does anybody have a Bible page number for those seminar Bibles? 490. 490. This is 1 Samuel chapter 28. Now I'm going to start in verse 3. 1 Samuel chapter 28, verse 3 says, now Samuel was, what's that next word? Now who was Samuel? Prophet of God. And Samuel was dead. And all Israel had lamented him. Then drop down to verse 6. And when Saul, now who's Saul? The king of Israel. Samuel's dead. Saul's the king of Israel. And when Saul inquired of the Lord, oh, Lord, talk to me. The Lord answered him not. Neither by dreams, nor by Urim, nor by... Now, who was the prophet of God that was there before for King Saul? His name was Samuel. And verse 3 tells us, now Samuel was... And God in verse 3 or verse 6 says, Saul, I'm not going to talk to you anymore. Then you get to verse 7. Then said Saul unto his servants, seek me a woman that hath a what?
Familiar
spirit, that I may go to her and inquire her. And his servant said to him, behold, there is a woman that hath a familiar spirit. Where? You've heard of the Bible event that's recorded, the Witch of Endor. This is it. Then you drop down to verse 11. So Saul has traveled. He's with the Witch of Endor. And we pick it up in verse 11. Then said the woman, whom shall I bring up unto thee? And he said, bring me up. So it's King Saul's asking the witch, bring me up Samuel. Verse 3 tells us Samuel was dead. Verse 6, God says, Saul, I'm not talking to you anymore. Let me ask a question. Very logical question. In the book of Isaiah chapter 1, God says, come now, let us reason together. So let's do a little bit of reasoning right now. Let me ask a question. God said, Saul, I'm not going to communicate with you anymore. Saul goes to the witch, says, bring me up Samuel. Does the witch have power to overrule God? No way. Okay, you with me on this so far? That's common sense, right? Verse 11, then said the woman, whom shall I bring up unto thee? And he said, bring me up Samuel. And when the woman saw Samuel, now let me ask a question. Did the woman see Samuel? Could not have. Does this woman, the witch, have power to overrule God? So it's not Samuel. I wonder who she's seeing. And when the woman saw Samuel, she cried with a loud voice, and the woman spake to Saul, saying, what hast thou deceived me? For thou art Saul. And the king said unto her, be not afraid, for what sawest thou? And the woman said unto Saul, I saw little g, plural, ascending where? Out of the earth. Saul goes to the witch of Endor. God says, I can't communicate anymore, and Samuel's dead. Can you bring me up Samuel, even though God said I'm not going to be able to communicate anymore through a prophet? And the witch says, sure, I'll do that, and brings up what they think is Samuel. And she said, I saw God's, little g, plural, ascending up out of the earth. Now I'm going to put the next verses up on the screen. Verses 14 says, and he said unto her, Saul said unto the witch, what form is he of? And she said, an old man cometh up, and he is covered with a mantle. Now let me back up. And he said unto her, what form is he? Now, why would King Saul be asking the witch, what does he look like? Because he can't see him. And then it goes on to say, and Saul perceived that it was Samuel. Let me ask a question. Was it Samuel? No. Who was it? It was God's, little g, plural, sending up. Coming as an apparition of Samuel. You follow that? Evil angels showing up as godly people. That's going to play key, having that understanding in an upcoming presentation. Back to the book of Daniel. Back to the book of Daniel. We'll pick it up where we left off, right there in verse 10, 11. We stopped in 11. We'll reread 11. Daniel chapter 2, verse 11. And it is a rare thing that the king requireth, and there is none other that can show it before the king except the gods. Now you know a little bit about those gods, right? Whose dwelling is not with flesh. For this cause the king was angry and very furious, and commanded to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. And the decree went forth that the wise men should be slain, and they sought Daniel and his fellows to be slain. Now why, when this death decree went out, are they seeking Daniel? Now, who's Daniel? Prophet of God. Jesus says, study Daniel the prophet. We're in his book. Why would King Nebuchadnezzar want to kill Daniel the prophet? He's not going after those guys, a little G plural. Right? Well, you see, when Nebuchadnezzar went and first captured Jerusalem, he took people back as captives. And then a little while later, Nebuchadnezzar went back and destroyed Jerusalem. But those first captives he took back were people that he saw had special gifts. And Daniel and his fellows were in that group. And King Nebuchadnezzar brought this special group back and put them into training for special places in his kingdom. And Daniel and his fellows became part of the wise men of Babylon, even though they were not the spiritual advisors as the sorcerers were that we just saw a moment ago, but they were counted as the wise men. So when the death decree went out to kill the wise men, Daniel and his fellows were in the lot with them. So verse 13, and the decree went forth that the wise men should be slain, and they sought Daniel and his fellows to be slain. Then Daniel answered with counsel and wisdom to Arioch, that was the captain of the king's guard, which was gone forth to slay the wise men of Babylon. Now, Arioch was the captain that Nebuchadnezzar said, you are in charge of going to kill this group. And when Arioch came to Daniel, Daniel said, wait, verse 14, verse 15. And he answered and said unto Arioch, verse 15, the king's captain, why is the decree so hasty from the king? Then Arioch made the thing known to Daniel. Then Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him. Now think about this. When the spiritual advisors first went into the king, and the king was saying, tell me what I dreamed, he's saying, wait a minute, you're trying to buy time. Remember we read that? That was in verse 8. And here we have Daniel going into the king, and he's saying, give me time. The very thing Nebuchadnezzar was accusing the other guys of doing. You know what this tells me? The Holy Spirit was working on King Nebuchadnezzar's heart when Daniel went in there. Because Daniel actually was a captive. Remember, he was taken captive from Jerusalem. And here Daniel's going in, desiring the king that he would give him time and that he would show the king the interpretation. Verse 17, then Daniel went to his house and made the thing known to Hananiah and Mishael and Azariah, his companions, that they would desire mercies of the... Now, that's capital G, singular. That's God the Creator. That's the one that we should be going to. Not little g, plural, but the God the Creator. Mercies of the God of heaven concerning this secret, that Daniel and his fellows should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel blessed who? You know that you can bless God? You know how you bless God? I'll give you a little hint. One way you can bless God, one of many ways, is when you read the Bible, prayerfully read the Bible, and the Holy Spirit shows you something in the Bible, and it's like, wait a minute, I didn't believe that before, or wait a minute, I haven't been living that way before, and you need to make a change according to the Scripture, and you see it clearly because the Holy Spirit just taught you. And when you choose, Lord, I'm going to do this, guide me into that truth, and you surrender to God, and you live what you learn, that's a blessing to God. Because God, it's like God saying, you know what? I sent you truth, sent the Holy Spirit, sent you truth, and you're showing that you respect it enough to live it. What a blessing for God that is. Do you want to bless God? Purpose in your heart to live up to the Word of God. Verse 20, Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changes the times and the seasons. He removed the kings and set up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that have no understanding. He revealeth the deep and the secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth in them. I thank thee and praise thee, O God of my fathers, who has given me wisdom and might and has made known unto me now what we desired of thee. for thou hast now made known unto us the king's matter. So here, God has revealed to Daniel as an answer to prayer the very thing he was praying for. Then you drop down to verse 27. Daniel has worked his way back into the king's court. Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, "The secret which the king hath demanded, cannot the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, soothsayers show unto the king, but there is a God in heaven." Amen. There's a God in heaven that revealeth secrets and maketh known to the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days. Thy dream and the visions of the head upon the bed are these. As for thee, O king, thy thoughts came unto thy mind upon the bed what should come to pass hereafter. And he that revealeth secrets maketh known to thee what shall come to pass. But as for me, this secret is not revealed to me for any wisdom that I have more than any living, but for their sakes that shall make known the interpretation to the king, and that thou mayest know the thoughts of thy... God reveals things to us to reveal our hearts. Bless God by living up to what God reveals. I'm going to put verse 31 up on the screen. Thou, O king, sawest, and behold, a great image. This great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. Now this image, here's the image. Daniel's describing this image. King Nebuchadnezzar saying, that's the dream. That's what I dreamed. And he goes on and says, the image head was of fine gold, his breasts and arms of silver, his belly and thighs of brass, his legs of iron, his feet of part iron and part of clay. Thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay, and brake them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, the gold, broken to pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away, that no place was found of them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. And this is the dream, and we will tell the interpretation thereof before the king. Nebuchadnezzar saying, that's it. You think he's going to trust the interpretation now? It wasn't God's little g plural. It was God, the creator in heaven, that revealed it to Daniel. And we know that God, the Holy Spirit, was already working on Nebuchadnezzar's heart because Nebuchadnezzar gave Daniel time. So here's the interpretation. Verse starting in verse 37. Thou, O king, art a king of kings. For the God of heaven hath given thee a kingdom, power, strength, and glory. And wheresoever the children of men dwell, the beasts in the field, and the fowls of heaven hath he given unto thine hand, and hath made thee ruler over them all. Thou, Nebuchadnezzar, art this head of gold. This dream God gave you, this statue, you're the head of gold, Nebuchadnezzar. Now, do we need to wonder what the head of gold represents? Or does the Bible clearly tell us? The Bible, true Bible prophecy, the Bible contains the keys to unlock it. And this is a very basic prophecy here that we're setting the foundation for this entire seminar. Nebuchadnezzar, this head of gold is you, represents you. Nebuchadnezzar's Babylon is the head of gold. Babylon's known as the Golden Kingdom. Known for that. Let's look at this. You ever heard of the Hanging Gardens, one of the seven wonders of the ancient world? Nebuchadnezzar built that. That's who that is. He made those for his wife, one of the seven wonders of the ancient world, the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. Babylon was 10 miles around, and by comparison, Rome was only 6 miles, and Athens was only 4 miles around. Big city. The temple of Marduk within Babylon was 300 feet high. Outside, this temple was covered with blue glazed tile. Inside, it was overlaid with gold. The altar and throne were made of 8.5 tons of solid gold. That's a lot of gold. That's a lot of gold. Then comes the bad news to King Nebuchadnezzar. In verse 39, and after thee shall arise another kingdom inferior to you. Nebuchadnezzar saying, wait a minute, you mean my kingdom's not going to last forever? So the head of gold is Nebuchadnezzar. The breasts and arms of silver are not Nebuchadnezzar. Take your Bibles. You're in Daniel 2. Go to Daniel chapter 5. I just want to briefly show you a couple of verses here. Daniel chapter 5. We'll start in verse 1, just three chapters up. Daniel chapter 5. Verse 1, Daniel chapter 5, verse 1. Belshazzar, the king, this is Nebuchadnezzar's grandson, made a great feast to 1,000 of his lords and drank wine before the 1,000. Belshazzar, whilst he tasted the wine, wasn't even drunk, just tasted the alcoholic beverage, commanded to bring the golden and silver vessels which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple, which was in Jerusalem, that the king and his princes, his wives, and his concubines might drink therein. Just as the wine was touching his mouth, he got holy, or I should say unholy boldness. Go get those holy vessels that were once in the temple in Jerusalem. Bring them here. We're going to drink from those things. Verse 3, then they brought the golden vessels that were taken out of the temple of the house of God, which was at Jerusalem, and the king and his princes and his wives and his concubines drank in them. They drank wine and praised the, oh, there's the gods, little g plural again. The gods of gold and silver, of brass, of iron and wood and of stone. And in the same hour came forth fingers of a man's hand and wrote over against the candlestick, against the candlestick upon the plaster of the wall in the king's palace, and the king saw the part of the hand that wrote. You ever heard the phrase, the cliche, the writing on the wall? This is where it comes from. A lot of our cliches come from Bible. Then the king's, in verse 6, then the king's countenance was changed, and his thoughts troubled him so that the joints of his loins were loosed, and his knees smote against of one another. The king cried aloud to bring to the in the astrologers. Oh, here we go again with the spiritual advisors. And the soothsayers. And the king spake and said to the wise men of Babylon, whoso shall read these writings and show me the interpretation thereof shall be clothed with scarlet and have a chain of gold about his neck and shall be the third ruler in the kingdom. Then came in all the king's wise men, but they could not read the writing, nor make known to the king the interpretation. Then was the king Belshazzar greatly troubled, and his countenance was changed in him, and his lords were ashamed or astonished. Now the queen, by reason of the words of the king and his lords, came into the banquet house, and the queen spoke and said, O king, live forever. Let not thy thoughts trouble thee, nor let thy countenance be changed. There is a man and the kingdom in whom is the spirit of the holy gods, and she's getting that wrong, is the spirit of God, capital G. And in the days of thy father, da, 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 goes talking about Nebuchadnezzar. This man of God in the kingdom, who do you think this man is? It's Daniel. She's saying, don't go to these guys. Do like Nebuchadnezzar. Go to Daniel. He's got connections. Do you want that connection Daniel has? Each one of us can have that connection. It's a connection to heaven. Letting the Holy Spirit teach us. So they have in this banquet, they bring in these holy vessels, and then all of a sudden there's a writing on the wall. And Belshazzar's knees start smoting together. He is so scared. He doesn't understand the writing on the wall. Bring in my spiritual advisors. Tell me what it is. I'll make you third ruler. Tell me what it is. They can't do it. So finally, Daniel comes in, and Daniel's looking up and says, you know what? I know what it says, and I don't want to be third ruler because I know what it says. And this is what it says. The writing was written, meeny, meeny, tickle you, farsin. This is the interpretation of the thing Daniel telling the king. He says, meeny, God hath numbered thy kingdom and finished it. Tekel, thou art weighed in the balances and art found wanting. Perez, thy kingdom is divided and given to the who? The Medo. So the head of gold represents Babylon. Arms and breast of silver, Medes and the Persians, Medo-Persia. And just as all those events were happening, the writing on the wall, guess who was marching underneath the walls of Babylon to take control of it? The Medes and the Persians. Just as Daniel is speaking it, it's happening. And that's Medo-Persia, the breasts and arms of silver. And then verse 39 of Daniel 2, and another third kingdom of brass, which shall bear rule over all the earth. Anybody know who conquered Medo-Persia, became the next worldwide empire of the known world, I should say? Anybody know? Greece, that's right. It's Greece. That's the waste of brass. And then verse 40, and the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron. Anybody ever heard the book, The Rise and Fall, or The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire by Gibbons? This is what he has to say of these images. He says, the images of gold and of silver and of brass that might serve to represent the nations and their kings were successfully broken by the iron monarchy of Rome. And we know it was the Roman Empire that conquered Greece, right? Now, Rome ruled from, and they came to prominent power in 168 B.C. Now, I have 476 underlying because that's when it fell apart. And we're going to talk about that in a minute. But 476 A.D. is a very important date to understand in these prophecies. So just tuck that in the back of your mind, and I will bring that up as we go through this seminar night after night. But something very happened under the Roman Empire, under the rule of the Roman Empire. And Luke chapter 2, verse 1, we find Caesar Augustus, Roman Caesar, given a decree for all the world to be taxed. And as a result of that decree, there was a man and woman who had to go to the man's ancestral town of Bethlehem. And while they traveled, the wife was 9 months pregnant. And once they got there, they had a baby. Anybody know who that baby was? It's Jesus. Luke chapter 2, verse 1, I got it up on the screen. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And that's what helped fulfill Bible prophecy of Jesus being born in Bethlehem. It took a decree from a worldly emperor. And Jesus lived that sinless life, that he can impute and impart his righteousness to each one of us and stand in our place and clothe us with his righteousness. And then when he died on the cross, that was for each one of us. So please, please, let's keep Jesus in mind, because Jesus says, I have told you before it comes to pass, that when it comes to pass, you will believe that I am he. Daniel chapter 2, verses 41 and 42, and the kingdom shall be divided as the toes of the feet were part of iron and part of clay. Let me ask a question. In a normal foot, how many toes are there? Five. There you go. That's good. Normal foot, there's five. Normal people that have the normal amount of feet have 10 toes. So just as you're coming down the legs of iron, Rome, and you're getting into the feet, when the Roman Empire divided, it divided actually into 10 divisions. Did you know that? When it first divided in 476 AD, let me put that up there. Whoops. Yeah, I got it right here. And these Germanic tribes, the divisions of the fallen Roman Empire, there's the list. Now, you're going to get a booklet when you leave tonight. It has all this in it, so I'm not going to read through this. It's in this booklet. But those are the 10 divisions of the fallen Roman Empire. The last three are destroyed. We'll talk about those in a different night, okay? So keep coming back. But Daniel chapter 2, verse 43, speaking of these 10 divisions, and whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, the feet, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men. What does that mean? Anybody know? Let me back up. Now, I don't know if it happened this way, but I'll explain it to help us to understand. The king and queen of England, because that's part of the 10 divisions, the king and queen of England would mingle their seed with the king and queen of France, trying to bring unity. You with me? So whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. So who's that a picture of there? Anybody recognize that picture?
Napoleon.
That's Napoleon. Napoleon tried to bring Europe back together. When the Roman Empire divided into 10, it was in the Mediterranean area, and it was Europe. That was the area of it. And so Napoleon tried to bring it back together. Was he successful? No. Why? Because God says they shall not cleave one to another. Charlemagne, he tried. Was he successful? How about the Kaisers? How about a guy named Adolf Hitler? He tried. He got real close, didn't he? No, he didn't. What about today? You got what's going on over there? You got the euro. They're trying to get with one currency and all that. Do you see it falling apart? You know why? God said, they shall not cleave one to another. It's not going to happen. There would not be. Now, they may come together and be in harmony with the various things, but there's still going to always be bordered territories. England's going to be England. France is going to be France. Greece is going to, you follow what I'm saying? They're not going to be back into one. They shall not cleave one to another. And in Daniel 2, verse 44, and in the days of these kings, what kings? Modern day Europe, if you will, shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand how long? Forever. No more kingdom changes once God's kingdom set up. Do you want to be part of that kingdom? You know, God's kingdom is a kingdom that doesn't change. God's kingdom is a kingdom that you can trust. You know, we look at the governments of today, and they're so wishy-washy. You know, you get one group of people that's in charge, and they make these laws. Then you get another group of people in charge, and they say, well, we didn't like those laws. We're going to make our own laws. Does that happen in this country? Oh, yeah. God's kingdom doesn't change. You know why? Because the Bible says, God records God saying, for I am the Lord God, I change not. Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. His word stands fast. And God's kingdom shall stand forever. For as much as thou sawest that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and it brake in pieces the iron, and the brass, and the clay, and the silver, and the gold. Didn't we read in Daniel chapter 5 that these were the gods? They also represent worship. And we're going to look at that in depth as we go through this seminar. Pretty interesting. The great God hath made known to the king what shall come to pass hereafter. And the dream is certain in the interpretation thereof. Sure. The word of God is sure. You can trust the word of God. So many people through the centuries, through the millennium, has tried to prove God's word false. And they haven't. What is it? I've heard it said, God's word is like the anvil that has broken many hammers. So many hammers has beaten against it, but the anvil stays. The foundation stays. God doesn't change. Now, we just went through Daniel chapter 2, and what I want to do is I have my little statue. And throughout this seminar, this little statue is going to stand here. Because I want, whenever we walk in, I want us to look at this little statue, head of gold, Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, thou art this head of gold, conquered by Medo-Persia, conquered by Greece, conquered by Rome. It wasn't conquered. It fell apart into 10 divisions. I want us to understand, every time we walk in and we see this, that God's prophecies stand fast. God knows what he's talking about. He told Daniel this, and Jesus said, go study Daniel the prophet. And God said in Amos 3:7 that he will not do anything unless he reveals his secrets to his prophets. Daniel foretold all this when this was just taking place up here in the hat. Nebuchadnezzar, he's the one who had the dream. And it stands fast. History confirms the fulfillment of Daniel chapter 2. Now, in the Bible, especially in the book of Daniel, there's a principle called repeat and expand. Daniel had this vision, four different times. Did you know that? Each time God gave Daniel this vision, Daniel recorded using different symbols. And each time that he recorded using different symbols, God would give him greater detail in the certain aspects of that vision. You follow what I'm saying? Repeating the vision with different symbols, and then expounding on certain aspects of the vision. The first time Daniel had the vision we just went through, Daniel chapter 2, it's the foundation of all Bible prophecies that we're going to be going through in this seminar. Daniel chapter 2 is the foundation. Everything is built from this. The second time Daniel had the vision is in Daniel chapter 7. Daniel chapter 2 is this image here. Daniel chapter 7 is actually the beast. So take your Bibles, open up to Daniel chapter 7. You're in Daniel chapter 5. Go to Daniel chapter 7. We're just going to briefly look through a couple of scriptures here, but a couple more principles that I want to show you from the screen. You can read it in the Bible if you want to. You're in Daniel chapter 7. Look in verse 17. Verse 17, and I have it on the screen also, but verse 17 says, these great, what? These great, which are four. You mean that's all a beast is? I thought this beast coming up out of the sea with 7 heads and 10 horns was this animal that doesn't exist yet. No, it's symbolic. The Bible tells us. See, learning this from the book of Daniel helps us to understand the book of Revelation. Isn't it the book of Revelation that has the beast? Beast of Revelation chapter 13. What does a beast represent according to the Bible? Kings. That's verse 17. Look what it says in verse 23. The fourth beast shall be the fourth. Now we're learning something. Beast represents a king, kingdom, nation. Yeah, really, we do the same thing today. You know that? The handwriting on the wall is a cliche we get from the Bible. You know that we do the same thing with beasts today, that we get it from the Bible. I'm going to name a beast, and you tell me what nation it represents. Bald eagle. Wow, a beast represents the United States. Bear. Hey. Rooster. France, very good. Beaver. All right. That's right. Beaver, it's Canada. So here you have, we do it today. Beasts represent kings, kingdoms, nations. That's all a beast represents, okay? Whenever you read about a beast in the Bible, in Bible prophecy, it's representing a nation or a kingdom or the king and the rulers. That's all it represents. The Bible tells us. So let's take a look at Daniel chapter 2. We've looked at that. What I'm going to do now, briefly, we're going to look at, we looked at the first time Daniel had a vision. Now we're going to briefly look at the second time and put the symbols of Daniel chapter 7 with our statue of Daniel chapter 2. So you're in Daniel chapter 7. Look in verse 4. So let's look at verse 3. Let's start in verse 3. And four great beasts, or kingdoms, came up from the sea, and the sea is symbolic as well. We'll look at that in an upcoming night. Diverse or different one from another. The first beast was like a... Now, in Daniel chapter 2, it wasn't a beast, it was a head of gold. And what did the head of gold represent? Babylon. So let's put that up here on the screen. Babylon is this lion. You know, you ever seen the gates that have been preserved in the museums in Germany of Babylon? Have you seen those gates in the walls? I should have put it on the PowerPoint, and I have pictures of them. You know what? They have reliefs made in stone, and they're blue walls. You know what those reliefs of an animal? Winged lions. And the Bible says that the first was like a lion. So we put that up there. Look in verse 5. And behold, another beast, and a second like to a... So let's put that up there. Now, today a bear represents Russia. In Bible prophecy, a bear represents Medo-Persia. And then you drop down and look in verse, we just read that, let's look in verse 6. And after this, I beheld, and lo, another like a... So let's put the leopard up there, and leopard is representing Greece there. You following this? It's the repeating. Then you drop down to verse 7. After this, I saw in the night vision, and behold, a fourth beast, a fourth kingdom, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great... Now, was there something in this statue here that had iron? It was the legs. Ooh, that's the next one. That's the fourth one, isn't it? And here we're seeing the fourth beast in Daniel chapter 7 has iron teeth. In Daniel 2, it was iron legs. Who do you think that's representing? Representing Rome. There's that 476 AD again. Keep that in mind. And it says, iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it, and it was diverse from all the beasts before it. And it had how many horns? 10 horns. Let's pause here a second. What do horns represent? Well, look what it says here in Daniel 7, verse 24. And the 10 horns out of this kingdom are 10 kings that shall arise. Horns represent kings and kingdoms just like the beasts do. You follow that? We see that from the Bible. But it said it has how many horns? 10 horns. Was there something in this statue somewhere around the legs of iron that were in a denomination of 10? It was the 10 toes. Wow. So let's put that here. 10 toes, 10 horns. And the 10 toes were the divided nations of the fallen Roman Empire. Do you think the 10 horns would represent the same thing? Absolutely. We just had God repeat this prophecy for us very briefly. But you see how it's repeated using different symbols. Then you get to verse 8 of Daniel 7. Daniel says, I considered the... Ooh. Now what God's doing here, he's saying, we repeated the prophecy of Daniel 2. We just repeated it in Daniel 7. Now I want our focus to be on something. I want our focus on the horns. This is where I'm going to expound on this prophecy. We're going to go in greater detail. So what he's really saying, he's saying, Daniel, I want you to look at the Mediterranean Sea, European area, geographically, after 476 AD. Why after that? Because the horns represent the 10 toes. They both represent the 10 divisions of the fallen Roman Empire. Those 10 divisions did not exist in 475 AD. Because in 475 AD, Rome did not divide yet. So the expounding of this prophecy is in this geographical area after 476 AD. Everybody with me? Say amen. See how God repeats, and now he's expounding on this, the horns. So what does he say? I considered the horns. And behold, there came up among them another. Now, what did a horn represent, the Bible tells us? Kingdom. So somewhere in this area, the Mediterranean Sea, Europe, in that area, sometime after 476 AD, a little kingdom's going to rise up. The Bible calls it a little horn. And with whom, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man and a mouth speaking great things. So we know a little bit about this little horn, this little kingdom that arises up in the European area there sometime after 476 AD. So after 476 AD, the Bible calls it the little horn in Daniel chapter 7. But the Bible also mentions it in other places as well. It is called the beast that rises out of the sea of Revelation 13. It's the same entity, same kingdom. You with me? It's also called the Antichrist of Bible prophecy. You've heard of the Antichrist, right? It's the same thing. These are all the same entity here, the same kingdom, little horn. But it's also referred to as the son of perdition. You with me? And we're going to look into these things. But the son of perdition, let's just look at this a little bit here in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. Let no man deceive you by any means. For that day, and what this context is for that day is talking about the second coming, that day shall not come except there come a falling away first. An apostasy of God's church first is what that's saying. And that man of sin be what? The son of... So this man of sin is referred to as the son of perdition. It's the same thing as the Antichrist, the beast that comes up out of the sea, and the little horn. Son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he, as God, sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. So this little horn that in Daniel 7, God's saying, this is what we're going to expound on, is claiming to be God. To receive worship. So let's ask the question, who is this son of perdition that sits on the throne thinking he's God? Who is this little horn? What great things will this little horn be speaking that Daniel 7 says he's going to be speaking these great things? Do you want to know the answer? Do you know what, you want to know where you can find the answer? In the Bible. That's where you find the answer. You can go to the Christian bookstore and read all that. Just like you can go to Newsweek. Go to Newsweek and read what the Bible says. What does Newsweek say? That's not safe. Go to the Bible for yourself. Amen? And the Bible will tell us all that. Amos 3:7. Surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secrets unto his servants, the prophets. And his prophets wrote it all down for us to study and learn. And the Holy Spirit would teach us. The Holy Spirit will guide us into the understanding. Do you want to have that experience of the Holy Spirit showing you all these things? Then come back tomorrow night. Tomorrow night we'll pick up part 2. We'll pick up right where we left off tonight. We'll do a little review of tonight, and then we'll expound a little bit more from the Bible and from the fulfillment of Bible prophecy. Jesus said, when you see these things come to pass, know, pardon me? I have told you before it comes to pass, so when it comes to pass, you might believe. And we can have an understanding. Jesus says we can understand it, because how will we know that it comes to pass unless we understand what it is? right? And he's revealed these things. So we're going to see tomorrow night, looking at history, looking at recorded history, looking at current events, based on the Bible, and find out who that son of perdition is, who that little horn power is that's sitting on the throne of God saying that he is God. Who is that? We want to avoid that, don't we? Amen? Anyway, is that your desire to come back tomorrow night and learn from this, from the Bible? I pray that it is. That's my desire to be here. I'll be here, Lord willing. And I pray each one of you would be back here. If that's what your plans are, I invite you at this time to stand as we have our closing prayer. And don't forget to get your handouts on your way out. You'll get this little booklet, and you'll get a brief outline of this presentation. And go home. Read this little booklet tonight, okay? Read it to refresh your memory of what we went through, and that'll help each one of us be prepared for tomorrow. So we'll get those handouts as we go home tonight. Let's bow our heads. Our kind, gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for revealing these things to us, Lord. Thank you for giving us the opportunity that we can open your word to study these things for ourselves. And Lord, thank you for the Holy Spirit being our teacher. Lead us and guide us to all these truths. And thank you first and foremost for your sacrifice, Jesus' sacrifice on Calvary, Lord. We're just so thankful that he was willing to leave the glories of heaven to come here to this place and do that for us. So we ask for your blessing as we are departing from this place. Take us to our destination safely, Lord. And we pray earnestly that you would give us a good night's rest and a good day tomorrow, and bring us back safely tomorrow night as we continue our study. Is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you and good night.